This video contains discussion of harm of children and self-harm and the experience of those who have lived through it. Please proceed with care. Hello everyone, my name is Alicia Jackson, licensed professional counselor, and welcome to my channel. Today we are reviewing Couples Therapy, episode 404. This is the fourth season and the fourth episode. Here at this channel, we do a different type of review. We do a different type of therapeutic review where we get a little curious. We sit and wonder like, what's happening internally that is making these couples show up in this way in these sessions? What's happening? What's happening in the therapist that's making her show up in this way? What's happening inside of us that we're responding and having such a big response to what's happening on the screen? We get a little curious. Want to learn a little bit about couples' relationships and hopefully potentially learn a little bit about ourselves. If you are returning, welcome back. Be sure to like the video and subscribe to the channel. Now let's get started. Now they switched up the format on us. First they had like we're doing one segment for a couple, one segment for another couple. Now we started one couple, then we moved to a couple, and then like they end the episode with that couple. So we're going to end our review with the couple, which is Mitch and Eliana. We're going to have them be at the end, and we're going to move right into Rex and Joey. So Rex and Joey are still like navigating this space, and to bring to your remembrance, they have been married for 10 months, and Rex and Joey are working through this situation where mom is not a fan of Rex because he's not a Christian. He's an atheist. Joey's a Christian, and mom has very, 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 very strong beliefs. It's called Rex a demon, has said he's like has had imagery that he's like this blob, a black blob. Like, and so Joey has decided to cut communication with her mother because of this, and also had her move out because they were living together, all of them in the same roof. And I'm like, how in the world could that happen? But that's what was happening. And so now they're trying to work through their relationship with this still in the background. Even though, you know, mom is still not in the relationship, she is still in the relationship as Joey is caring. Joey's carrying those beliefs, those thoughts, those feelings that, like, I want to do right by my mother. Maybe my mother is right. I don't want to betray my mother. So all of those things are happening internally, and they're showing up in their relationship. So Joey talked about how they are discussing to have children, not to have children, but it's hard because she doesn't really know what Rex thinks. And we kind of last episode saw that Rex has a hard time identifying his feelings, his thoughts, his own beliefs. Like that's a hard thing for Rex to sit with. So the therapist asks for both of them, like, hey, let me see you all. Just talk about it, which is really great because sometimes we can hear them talking about their dance that they do, but to see it, it gives us a really good picture of what's happening. And one of the therapists is also wanting to enter, like, do intervention as they are doing their dance. And so they talk about it. And Rex is saying, we lead a busy life, and my schedule is morning, day, night. And so Joey was like, okay, so if we had the perfect schedule, would you be open to having children? He's like, if we were, you know, there for the kid, if we could be there for the kid, like this is a deal breaker for Rex. If we could be there for the kid, then yes, I would like to have a child. And that was like something the therapist had to even like coach Rex with, of like naming something that he wants and like I want. So it feels like a lot of Rex's experience have been like denied that he has needs, that his needs, not to speak for his needs, all of this. So this, even as he's saying it, he can see it's like very robotic. He's like, I would like to have a child. And I know it sounds silly me saying it right now, or at least to me, my parts. And that's like exactly how he was saying it, because he's like pushing through his defenses to say, I would like to have a child if we had the perfect schedule. And so Joey's like, man, this is great to know, because now I'm less confused about what you want. And so the therapist noticed, like, okay, I see you searching keenly, like, to know, like, what he wants. And so then I'm wondering, what do you want? Like, what are your wants? What are your needs that you want around this? And Joyce, like, I've always wanted to have children. I've always desired to have children, but it has decreased over time because of how mom has responded to the relationship and has discouraged her almost to have a child, saying that if she did have a child, that it would die, which is like, wow. That's a lot to be getting from your mother. Because we have these parts of us really young that really believed everything our parents said, saw them as the authority on life, because hey, they were our guide. So of course they know. And so when they're hearing mom say this, I could imagine that there's a part of her that, even though logically she doesn't believe it, but I'm wondering here, like, how that lands to hear your mother say, if you have a child with Rex, the child is going to die. And so Rex said that 90% of the things that comes out of her mother's mouth is like very biblical and heavy Christian stuff, and to the point where she's been like on the floor, like crying or rolling around on the floor, and they have locked their bedroom door because they thought, and I guess he thought, that her mother was going to harm Rex. And I'm like, wow. Like, that's a lot. That's a lot to be navigating. And remember, Rex had no feelings about this. All, like, he's naming it now because, like, more space is being made for his voice. And now that he's opening his voice, listen. Like, listen to what is being spoken for, which is, oh my goodness. Oh my goodness. And so the therapist pointed to, like, all these themes that her mother carries around death and everything. It seems to be very life or death, big life or death situations. Like, mom is feeling like this is a dangerous situation and she will be cursed. She will die. Think like there's no middle. There's no middle at all. There's no space for Joy to make a decision for herself. If she does, then this is what will happen. Or if she makes a decision, it has to align with what her mother is believing. So there's this part of her mind that is like, this is the way to go, and it's found this way to go. And if you don't go this way, then it's going to lead to death. And whew, that's a lot to be holding in her mother's body. That's a lot to be holding in Joey and Rex. Like, all of that's a lot. And so we're seeing how they are navigating this. And Joey stated that it feels good for Orno, the therapist, to name like these extreme high stakes that mom is putting on her relationship with Rex, because it's really validating. It's almost, she said, they numbed it. Like, parts of them have numbed out this, and makes sense when we're going through something that is very distressing, very, very distressing. And over the period of time, our nervous system finds ways to like cool it down, to bring us down to some form of calm. It may not really be calm, but it's a controlled calm. It's a checked out calm. It's, unaware, kind of aloof, maybe not having feelings, numbing things out. Why? To help us in these moments, because to be at this level of distress so much is too much for our system to navigate, to take. And so Orna, the therapist, also points out that yes, this is also to limiting your abilities to make your own decisions, to speak for what you want, because she's seeing from her seat that both of them can't make a decision or speak for what they want about having a child because it's been limited. Like, one, the child's going to die if they have it, a part of her beliefs. And Rex,
he's not even able to say what he wants. And that limits their ability to really navigate their own relationship and make decisions about their relationship. And so Rex stated that hearing Joey talk about her mom, hearing that triggers how, as a child growing up, he did not want things to be like it was for him with his dad, because his dad was always busy. Always busy. He said, remember earlier, he said, my days are packed morning, noon, and night. Meaning I don't want my child to be lonely or to be without their parent like I was. And you see tears come in his eyes. You see the sad child, very similar to what happened last episode, like the sad child is very there. And the therapist points it out to Rex as almost to acknowledge that child that's there and said, oh, you look so sad. And Rex kind of instinctively deflects, right? There's a part of him that says, oh no, I'm more sad for Joey, not for myself. So there's a part of him that doesn't even realize that this sadness is it may be like it may be connected to Joey, but it's also connected to his story, but he's not aware of it. And so the Orna, the therapist, says, of course. And I said, oh yeah, I would, you know. And I see she's playing it where she's just inviting him to have the feeling. So to invite him to have the feeling and then say, ooh, these feelings are yours, that may be too much. So she's just like slow walking it with Rex, because there's a part of me that's inclined to say, yeah, I'm sure you are really sad for Joey and also sad about not able to spend time with your dad, huh? Like, just to kind of, ooh, right? Bring it back in and see if he's able to connect with like his own story. And so Joey's saying, yes, this is what I wanted. This is what I wanted. This is what I needed. I wanted to know how you feel and to be honest with each other, because the more I know, the less I can be in my head, right? These parts of me that are really focused on what mom wants me to do, I can make more space for our decisions. And so the therapist even encouraged, which I understand, she encouraged her to talk more about wants instead of decisions, because decisions can make things a little complicated. We just speak for what we want. I want this. Because we can speak for that in clarity, or part of me wants this, or part of me wants that. And then if we get there, then we can get to the decisions. Like it's a process. And so Rex said, yeah, like I want her body. Like I want to be physically intimate with my wife. And when I bring it up, it doesn't happen. I try to touch her. She flicks my hands away for days, for months, for years. And the therapist said, yeah, do you have anything to say about this, Joey? And Joey said, well, it's gotten to the place where it's unpleasant. And I'm uncomfortable and it hurts and there's a lot of fear around it. Ah, this has to go somewhere, right? So this fear, this distress, even though we're numbed out, even though we're checked out about it, we don't have any feelings about it, that's where we started. Now we're talking about it and we're seeing how it's impacting the relationship. We're even afraid to connect because what might happen? What might happen? We're afraid to connect. Our body has responded in a way. And yes, there may be some other factors too that may be making their intimacy or physical intimacy unpleasant, and things that may need to change and shift. And also too, if her body won't even allow her to be in a space to receive, because if I do, this is what will happen. Then, yes, things will be unpleasant. Things will hurt because that's directly connected. You know, our parts get information and they do things in order to keep us alive. Hey, if we don't have a child, then they won't die. So let's not even do this. Let's not do this so we won't have a child. Because the pain of losing a child, oh my goodness, it's unbearable. Oh, the grief. I mean, that's a traumatic grief, because that's not something that you that parents prepare for. They prepare to be buried, or to right to have their children carry on, not to lose a child. So she's got all this fear in her body, and this is how it's responding. And so, yeah, Rex is like, there's a huge sacrifice for me because years I've been going without. And so therapists just, and it was nice. It was nice to see her do this, where she kind of brings Joey back in and say, yeah, Joey's sacrificing too. Why wouldn't Joey want to have a healthy physical connection with you? Right? She's also both of you are sacrificing this. Like, yes, the sacrifice that he's making is having an impact on him, which is important, and space needs to be made for that. And also too, this is impacting Joey too. And mom, the therapist posed a question like, oh, how is mom benefiting from the sacrifice? And she's like, well, I don't know. Like, if I don't, we don't physically connect, then I don't have a child. So then the therapist said, huh, so the child is being sacrificed for your mother. Now that's biblical. Very, very. This is very interesting dynamic. I know I said it last episode that, and I'm chuckling because I'm like, let's walk that back. We're like, ooh, this could be a great family therapy exploration. I don't think we're there yet. Like, there's a lot that needs to be unearthed in regards to Rex and Joey. Both of them, their parts, have gotten messages that your feelings don't matter. Don't speak for them. Loyalty to parents, and we get those if we get these thoughts directly or indirectly, and or through our experiences, and we take them in at the time where our brain doesn't have the nuance to understand context. So all of that is happening, and at the same time too, mom is very much in real time reinforcing these beliefs in real time. And that is a real huge barrier to their relationship and to them being able to tap into themselves to know what they want for their relationship. It'll be interesting to see how things progress. We shall see. Next, we have our throuple, and this is Aaron, Josh, and Lorena. And so, for those who haven't been watching every episode, every review, Josh and Aaron have been in a partnership for 8 years. Lorena and Josh have been in a partnership for 2 years. And Lorena and Aaron are not in a partnership together, and they all collectively have and connect with other people outside of this throuple. Josh lives in a collective space. He goes to visit Lorena, and I believe Aaron, like, maybe lives or visits in that collective space as well. So that's kind of the makeup of this relationship. And so we start kind of in the middle, as always. We start in the middle where Lorena is like, okay, coming from this place, like this part of her that is, you can tell, like, is losing hope. She's like, Josh and I are in this space where we're in this big hole, and it's deep, and it keeps getting deeper and deeper, and we're getting stuck, and there's like no getting out of this. And so therapist said, okay, tell me more. I want to hear more about what you're experiencing. And so Lorena said that she was invited to Aaron's family barbecue because Aaron's father was coming in town. So they're having a get together. And Josh invited Lorena. And Lorena said, well, I've never met Aaron's family. And I believe that Aaron's family does not know that she's Polly. So I don't, like, there's a part of her that doesn't want to intrude. And it's coming from a place where she's still feeling very, like, secondary, very, like, well, yeah. Aaron's really important, and Lorena, you're important too, right? Like, that's how Lorena experiencing this relationship, experiencing Josh. And Erin also confirmed that her parents don't know. Her parents do not know that she is poly. And Lorena asks Josh about the barbecue. Like, okay, so what's going on? Can I come? Can I not come? What's the dynamics? And he said, well, you can come, but just our dynamic, our throuple situation can't really be known, can't really be spoken to. And that hurt Lorena. She said she was super hurt about it. And then that Monday of that week, whichever day this was happening, they had a date night planned. And that Sunday evening, he said, oh no, I double booked. Let me go check in with Erin about this. So she said she, after this phone call, again, just tears and feeling very secondary, feeling like a secondary partner. And that's how they're functioning. That's very much how they're functioning. So, you know, it's sometimes we feel like, oh, our insecurities are lying to us. Sometimes our feelings are really communicating to us what is happening in the moment. And so this is the dynamic. And so this dynamic is making her feel insecure, which is then making her say she feels less confident to really plan for the future, which are things that Josh was naming last week, our last episode, that he was upset about. Like, he was upset about the fact that she can't plan for things. And she's like, well, I don't feel comfortable planning for things, because if I plan something and you have something with Erin, is it going to be canceled? Is it going to be pushed aside, adjusted? And I'm working with my own nervous system, and I'm speaking for Lorena. Like, she's already working with her own nervous system around the fact that she already doesn't like to plan, because her mother was giving like a very short time to live, and she lived a very long time past that. And so that's all that ambiguity, all that questioning and wondering. She doesn't like to plan. That's something that she's working through. She's wanting to be better about. And at the same time, the dynamic of this relationship is further activating that part of her that doesn't, like, I don't feel secure. I don't feel secure. Okay. And so she said that she has an idea, and she also feels like they too, of what a non-hierarchical relationship, I think that's how you say that word, right, is, and what a primary relationship is. However, what's happening and what's actually isn't aligned with what's actually happening in the relationship. Kudos to Lorena for working through that. That can be very challenging when you're experiencing something and someone else is telling you, no, it's not like that. It can be a tug of war internally within yourself to name and to still fight to be heard, because we see even in this session that Josh is having a hard time hearing her. And I'll say more about that a little bit later, but you can see that he's having a hard time hearing her. And so the therapist asked Erin, share more? Can you share about this dynamic? And Erin said it went after she cheated on Josh. Josh told her that she blew, right? So there's this part of him. Remember, what did you do? It was last session. What did you do? You cheated. That's what it was, a betrayal. You cheated. Say what you did, right? And then this other part of him came in and was like, thank you so much for saying this. You're so brave. You're so wonderful. I can't, you know. And so we got these two. So this one that's like, say what you did. It feels like it's in these moments. It's like, you blew all the rights to say what this relationship is out of the water. Like, you blew that out the water. And so Erin says, because of that, because she took that in, she's accepting what Josh is saying. There's a part of her that it seems like sometimes Erin has a part of her that her voice gets really lost in this relationship, and she complies a lot. She seems to comply a lot with the part of Josh that makes these big demands. And so she said, I feel like I didn't have a right to say what I want in this relationship. And I really do. Like, I really want a primary relationship. That's what I want. Then the therapist reflects. Orna, she kind of asks all three of them. So the decision makers are you two. She points Josh and Erin, and Lorena is in the middle, and she's like, the both of them. Okay. With a smirk, a like with the like, ugh, this is so uncomfortable, this is so painful. Sometimes we have these smirks and these laughs to make things just a little lighter, a little lighter. And I'm also hearing the pain that Lorena is in being in this crossfires, because I see where she's caught up in a triangle, and we'll keep going. I'll circle back. I promise. I'm like close to, like, I want to spill the beans, but she's caught up in this triangle. They agree somewhat. Josh kind of pushes back some, well maybe sometime, what, and like, no, this is it. They are the decision makers. And so the therapist cuts in because she has this part of her that wants to manage Josh's inability to listen, or his fear, because it really is, it's a fear he has about listening to Lorena, to Aaron. And he has to fight. He feels the instinctive nature to fight, to defend whatever he's feeling and thinking in that moment. She said, so who wants to change that? Notice there was silence. And notice there was a smile and a giggle there. Lorena's just sitting there in the middle and was like, I guess I'm the one. I guess that's my part. Like, I want to fix that. The therapist said, okay, well, are you alone in this? And kudos to Aaron. I feel like this is such a big move. Oftentimes, it is very hard. It is very hard to say and speak an uncomfortable truth. And I feel like what happened in this moment was Aaron leaning in to speak for her uncomfortable truth and have the courageous conversation. She said, you know, I feel like I need to own the fact that a part of me likes a little control. And I want to know more about this part of her that likes to be in control. What is it protecting her from? What is it trying to control? By being the primary partner, how does that protect Aaron? What does that do for her? And then Josh named his uncomfortable truth. His courageous truth of, he said, and you could see the smile on his face when he said it. He said, you know, and after Aaron cheated, a part of me wants to give her less control. And then that smile that the therapist noticed last session, that smile came up. He wants to give Aaron less control. Let's sit and wonder about that. Right? Like, let's sit and wonder about that. What's there? There's a concern about Aaron having so much control now. Yes, there's a part of him that may delight in the fact that she wants control and he wants to take it away from her. However, he's doing that in a way to be protective. Everything we do is out of protection. That betrayal hurt him. And now there's a part of him that feels like it is seeking some type of vengeance. It's seeking some type of repercussions for his hurt, instead of him attending to his own hurt. He is externally reaching out to Aaron and Lorena to fix this hurt. This is the crossfire. However, it's not going how he's planning it to go. Like, this part of him, it seems like it wants Aaron to pay and Lorena to be where he finds some kind of solace and peace and healing and finds some solace, some peace, some validation of his worth, his value. Like, and what happens though, because Lorena pauses him, like she stops, and she's like, do you see how in all of these scenarios though, that the top priority maker is Aaron? And he's interrupting. She said, just listen. There's a part of her that's really advocating for her voice to be heard right now. And she's like, the barbecue. If I want to plan something. And he's like shifting in his seat. It's hard for him to sit still. She said, just be curious. And I want to tell Lorena, I wish it was that easy. I wish it was that easy to tell someone, hey, can you be curious right now? And then something switches them, like, okay, I'm curious, because the fight is still in there. Like, I can't. There's some discomfort about hearing what she has to say, about the fact that even though you want her to have less control, she still has it. And I'm wondering, I don't know, I really don't. I'm wondering, what discomfort does that bring Josh, knowing that? Yeah, actually, I want her to have less control. And then Lorena says, but nothing's changed. She still has control. And she's making every decision. Every decision. She is the main decision maker in this relationship. I wonder, what discomfort does that bring? Does that bring, oh, I'm still in the line, like the line of danger, like she can still hurt me like she did before. I'm just allowing her to do this. I'm afraid of losing her. What's there? We don't know. Something's there. It's very interesting that Lorena's like caught in this situation, and she has this part that is truly advocating, speaking up for herself, speaking up for her experience, and I have to again highlight how Aaron and Josh are naming what's happening for them, and it can be really hard to calm our defenses and truly hear someone out, especially if there's a fear of listening. There's a fear of listening, and we are still fighting to be heard. To be heard. So I'm hoping that Josh was able to lean into his curiosity around what Lorena shared and be open to sit with himself about what that means for him and what that means for their relationship, all of them. How, you know, they said they want this, but, well, only one person seems to want this non-hierarchical relationship. And it seems like Josh and Aaron are in a space where they want a primary partnership. But the hurt part of Josh is like, okay, I'm with you, Lorena. Let's do this non-hierarchical relationship. But nothing's changing. Something for them to get curious about for sure. Next, we have Alexis and Casimir. And as previously stated in prior videos, know that Alexis and Casimir are dealing with some heavy content. So please, please govern yourselves accordingly and take care of your systems when taking in this content. And so Casimir is naming their depressive episode, something we haven't really sat with, but saying that when they are feeling really down, and they start to feel paralyzed and really can't function. And so Alexis will go off. He will save the day. He'll make the money. He has this part of him, which he named, I can't remember, it was last week's episode, the one prior, this part of him that's like, I fought for my independence and now I must keep it. I have to survive. And so he's like, I don't have the luxury of being in the state of doing nothing. I have to get up and I have to make it happen or I won't be okay. And so that makes Casimir feel worse. And it fuels this narrative, and I wonder if this is coming from them, like internally, parts of them that are have this narrative that they don't do anything, and it brings up this feeling of worthlessness. And I also wonder if this is also in their family, like this narrative of Casimir not doing anything and being maybe lazy. I don't know, you know, what messaging they've received around oppressed. But we hear as the session goes on that Kazmar was not allowed to really feel what was happening when they were experiencing these things. Kazmar said, this is then the fights start. So like in this space, feeling worthless, and then fights erupt. And so in consultation, or another therapist names what's happening, the dynamic between the two, where Alexis is doing these renovation projects and real estate properties and rejuvenating the places, renovating them and turning them into Airbnbs as a way to get himself out of poverty. So this is not just working to work. We're working to survive. We're work and internally for him, if he stops, then he will be out of control. And if he is out of control, then he's in that space where the pain happens. So that's the driving force. That's the driver that's in the driver's seat when he's saying, I don't have the luxury to, which I don't know what the impact of that is on Kazimar. However, that's what that drive is. It's like, I have to work. And Kazimar is the designer. Kazimar makes the spaces look beautiful and also has ADHD, of course, you know, trauma and depression that makes it really hard for them to function fully. And Kazimar provides a lot of emotional support, which Alexis did not get. So they're both meeting each other's needs in ways that they didn't receive it in their family of origin. Kazimar is providing the emotional support for Alexis, and Alexis is providing the financial stability that Kazimar did not receive. Two wounded children reaching out to get their needs met. Ha, I found this wonderful human who also can provide these needs that were not met. Okay. So that, I feel like that framework really helps us to see like what they're fighting for and why it's so hard in their moments of conflict, because I'm sure there's also that scared child who is scared of losing that emotional support or that financial stability if they have moments, you know, in their moments where they're fighting, because they're fighting to be heard, they're fighting for that, and they're also fighting not to lose what they didn't have before. So Kazimar goes on to give more clarity about their lived experiences, talking about a time where their mother was crying, said, oh, they're going to be homeless, they got evicted, and she just broke down, and Kazimar didn't. He said, hey, didn't my aunt go through this? Something similar, maybe she can help. And their mother started stopped crying, and she was like, you're right. And so a couple hours from there, they reached out and got some support, and they were in a shelter. And Kazimar was like, if I didn't do that, I don't know if my mom would have gotten the help. I don't know if we would have got it because she was so distraught. And the therapist was right there with Kazimar saying like, how did you feel to hear, right? To hear and see your mom so overwhelmed, so distraught. And Kazimar said, how do I fix this? And Kazimar named, they're only 12, and feeling the burden of rescuing their family from homelessness. But like that is, I don't know what that weight feels like. I don't even know if Kazimar fully knows the weight of that, because it sounds like there's a lot of protection around them regarding like this financial insecurity, this financial instability, this poverty, this need to survive, because we need it, right? We need finances to survive. And when you have that lived experience of lack and you're at 12 holding your family together, what is that? What's the impact of that on Kazimar's nervous system? I would love to hear what that 12-year-old experienced and what they were really feeling versus what support Casimir had in the moment. Because we get to learn a little bit more about that. Casimir and Nane, they were stuck in a room with like younger sibling. They were hungry, and it was like a very small room. It's at a fraction of the size of the room that they were in the therapy room. And they couldn't complain. So I couldn't complain. Life just goes on. And Orna, the therapist, she's naming, like, she's like, I'm thinking about how you had to take care of yourself and stick to the positive. Like, stick, keep your mind focused on the positive as a way of survival. Like, don't think about that. Push that to the side. Split. What Orna named as the dissociation that happens instinctively. I wanna name that. Like, it can happen very instinctively that our brain just says, I don't wanna think about that. Boop. And like, let's just knock that to the side. We gotta think about the positive. And Casimir said, yeah, I mean, that was the image that my mother really wanted. We were homeless, and before that there was physical harm happening in the home, in their relationship with Casimir's parents, where he walked in trying to save mom, and mom told Casimir to leave because she was scared for them to get hurt, and told Casimir to go. And the therapist said, you had to ignore awful things. Yeah, as a way of survival, he had to, yeah, push that to the side and ignore the pain. And Casimir said, yeah, when you go outside, nobody knows your problems, and you don't want to let everyone know your business, so you do the best you can. You button up, you zip up, you put on a happy face. Hey, how you doing? That's something that instinctively was a pattern. So then the therapist checks in on Alexis to see how he's doing hearing all of this, because I know where she's going. I know where she's going. Casimir named the exact pattern of harm that was in Alexis' home. You just ignore it and keep it moving. That's what Alexis experienced. So she's checking in on Alexis. How are you? And where are you listening to this? Are you here? Are you dissociated? Are you checked out? Where are you? And he said, well, it's very different for me, because, you know, when their relationship first started, Casimir had these very serious bouts of depression. It feels like in those moments where they met, it's like part of Casimir felt like, oh, I can finally feel all those things I've been needing to feel, being homeless, being in this very chaotic, unsafe environment, I can now feel with you. Oh, okay. And the bouts of depression were very heavy, and they would cry, and then the next morning Casimir was up and smiling. And it was very jarring to Lex's system to hear Casimir on the phone with their mom, like, hey mom, what's up? When for Alexis, he said for his life, it's been 32 years of him, this part, like, working to find his voice, to not be a victim anymore. And so then the therapist reflects, right? She reflects what's happening. So Alexis, you have experienced pain and harm and have been systemically silenced. And so that would make sense on why you're sensitive to that. Yeah, there is a lot of sensitivity to that, because that was Alexis's experience, and there's a lot of protection. Your voice needs to be heard. So he's got a part of him that's like, there's one that's like, let's be silent. Let's just go along to get along, because that's what everybody else is doing. And then he's got a part of him that's saying, your voice needs to be heard. Speak up. You don't be a victim. You can't do this. You have to say it. You have to say it. And so when Alexis sees Casimir say, hey mom, what's up? Like, everything is okay. Then that ignites a fire inside of Alexis. How could it not? And then Alexis is inviting Casimir to be with him in his pain. It's going to send those alert systems off because Casimir is saying, that's not what you do. You do the opposite of that. You keep it moving. Think about the positive. Don't think about that too much. And that silences Alexis' truth. And so they are instinctively, because of where it's directly connected to their story, they're not doing this maliciously. They're not doing this in a way of like, I'm going to make sure that Alexis' pain isn't heard. I'm going to invalidate his experiences of his family. Not what's happening. Or I'm going to make Casimir feel worthless because they can't get out of bed and I have to. Like, there's no, like that. I don't feel like that's what's happening. What's happening is like their experiences are clashing with each other in this relationship. And Alexis nods, yes, that's what's happening. Because Casimir saying, as my way of survival was to pretend that what was happening was not. And Alexis said, I had to fight to make sure I said what happened. And I owned what happened as a way of me fighting for my survival. And so Casimir named that there's a, like, that's the part of the reason why they get so anxious when they have a fight, because Casimir's like, we can't stay here. We got to get over this. Okay. We got to get over this because happiness is over here. Let's not stay here. And therapists even like provided more clarity, because being here, being in this space is like sadness and helpless and overwhelmed in that small room and hungry. Casimir, yeah. It's like, I already got depression. I already have depression, and I can't control when my depressive episodes come in. So I can't control that. But what I can control is how I think about my experiences. I could be hungry, or I can go to a happy place in my head. I could be hungry, which they are, right? They were hungry in that room. No food. However, too painful to be in that space, in that moment, at 12 years old, don't really have the emotional capacity to hold all of that, and especially by yourself, if you have people around you doing the same. Going to a happy place in their mind, acting as though everything is okay. So, Casimir said, well, I could distract myself. I could distract myself, or I could see how small this room is, how the walls are closing in on me. I could do that. It's like, no, I can't. I can't do that. I feel like this episode was a great way for them to see the dance that's happening for them internally, and to know who's pulling the levers in the dance and what's contributing to the dance, and that this is directly connected to their experiences. Hopefully this will help create a little bit more space for them, having this clarity, a little bit more space for understanding and compassion for each other in the moment, hopefully. But our nervous system is going to respond in a way that's going to respond to keep us safe. That it will. And so it'll be interesting to see how things continue to unfold with them. Last, we have Eliana and Mitch. And again, they start at the beginning of the episode, and Eliana's like, okay. Mitch is sleeping the floor. He's sweeping the floor, and she's like, bro. She has this part of her that talks to him in this like friend like energy, like, bro, but it's like a, like, I'm checking you energy. Like, this part of her that's like, bro, you're gonna have to do this twice because you're sweeping the floor, but you haven't wiped off the counters. And so the therapist is like, okay, do you know what my response is going to be? What do you feel like I'm going to say? And Eliana's like, that I have OCD. She's like, well, do you? She said, yeah, like multiple forms of it. Talked about how she has to like have clean certain areas in certain ways and count, use numbers to count. And then Orna does the thing, a beautiful thing, by affirming her. She's like, yeah, it's great to have someone who has OCD in your life because it really can be. And it won't work if you apply it to your partner. Well, yes, absolutely, Orna. I 100% agree with you. I feel like, too, and of course, I'm going to be biased, but the thing I love about IFS, and that's the model that I use to do my reviews, that we need to sit with and understand this OCD. I feel like we just kind of stopped, and maybe they do in the therapy session a little bit more, but really kind of understanding like, oh, what is this behavior here doing for Eliana? Like, what is it protecting her from? What's here? There's a lot of work that happens in the mind with obsessive behaviors or compulsive behaviors, and there's a reason why the brain does it. And so I want to know more because I feel like what can happen and what I'm seeing is happening is that it's like, all right, Eliana has this behavior, and this is driving this dynamic in the relationship. And it's like, yes, Orna, yes, because she even named this in her consultation. Because of course they go to the other couples, but then they come back to her talking about Orna, talking about Eliana and Mitch, saying that she has this intense drive and ambition, and she controls everything, their schedule, and her complaint is that this guy does nothing. And so it's going to be tough for them to break out of this. And also that she suspects or she feels like Eliana may not feel like Orna's on her side. Well, yeah, because it feels like the message I'm getting through Orna's talk with this therapist is that the OCD is the problem. And so the part of her that is used, like either using these obsessive behaviors or compulsive behaviors, or the part of her that needs them, it's going to feel like, what are you talking about? My OCD behaviors are the problem. It's going to be on defense. It's going to be on alert. So Orna's experiment or her proposition is for Mitch to take the reins. Mitch to start to take more of the reins in their relationship. And the consultant is like right there with Orna, like yes. And so and if things fall apart, like he's gonna have to be okay to know that Eliana could put you down. She could hurt you. Like we're gonna do this with creating this container. Like this can happen because this is the dynamic that's happening in their relationship. And it will be interesting to see how things go. I feel like there's a reason. There's a reason for everything. And so I feel like this experiment will further prove or show more of the reason for, not for the compulsive behaviors. I feel like that was probably here before they met. However, there's a reason why a part of Eliana has felt this need to step in to take control of the reins. And that feels like that's not being acknowledged in this space, in this setting, as of now. So the therapist checks in. So we come back to them, and the therapist checks in with Mitch and says, okay, let's try to have a workable contract where you handle the duties around the house. You take the lead. And what would that look like? And so Mitch says, well, what happened in my house? Everybody handles their own space. That's how we grew up, and everything worked. And Eliana is doing this. She's shaking her head like, no. She said, I've been to your mom's house. There's dishes just thrown in the sink, and she wakes up at 4 o'clock in the morning, and she cleans the entire house before she goes to work. image said yes, that is true for the most part. They do have their specific responsibilities, but for the shared spaces, his mom cleaned the house. And so the therapist said, okay, well, what are we going to do about these shared spaces? How are you going to navigate this? And so right now what's here is, and this is a, to me, this is a trap I've fallen into many a times, where we get into a fix it kind of mode, where because I'm sensing like part of Orna, the therapist, is like, let's here's the problem. There's this dynamic where Eliana has all of this burden to order Mitch around to do everything. What if we give Mitch the fix? And then we start to like, we start to work through and problem solve the fix. Wouldn't it be great if that was just the answer? But I sense that there's so much underneath here that's not being addressed. Even in the body language that is showing in this session, pretty much majority of the time, Mitch has his hand on his forehead, like he's exacerbated, he's exhausted, he's got this, he's doing this, he's like, ugh. Like he is, his hands, it's almost like he's just covering himself, like, ugh, just feeling the weight. And then you see Eliana is like, she's activated. She's like, she's holding it. She's fit, like, she's, her body image is very much like a, it's like, see me, see me, see me. Like, that's what I see her body communicating in these sessions. And I don't know if problem solving is going to address that. I really sense that it's not. And so this is where we are, though. We're in this session, and Mitch is like, okay, I'll pick the shared spaces that I want to clean. She has a specific way she wants to do the bathroom. She'll keep that. I don't really like how she cleans the kitchen. I'll take responsibility for that. And Eliana had lots of facial expressions around that. So there's a part of her that took offense or was hurt by that. And he said, when it comes to the living room, bedroom, we just pick up after ourselves. And so Orna, the therapist, like, proposed for a whole week for this to experiment to happen. And Mitch says, well, I'm open to it, but, you know, I got to be there more often. So I would have to be there for a week. Again, his face is like covered. He's like, like, it's almost like he's not, I feel like in his body language is saying like, I don't know if I could do this. That's what I'm sensing. I don't know if that's what that is, but it's just like I don't wanna, I can't. That's what I see. And so I feel like that needs to be named. Like, ooh, tell me what's happening, Mitch, for you right now as we're problem solving this, what's coming up? Because that can be helpful for Orna to know what energy is in the room. And so the therapist named, like, she's diagnosed the dynamic that Eliana is sacked with too much of the authority of what's going on. And ooh, that word authority, it triggered something in Eliana. She said responsibility. And then Orna, the therapist, is like, I'm going to use another word, authority. And this is burdening. She's like burdened by this and putting you in a tough spot. And maybe you need to take the reins some more. And so Eliana says, okay, maybe I'm not making myself clear. And so this is where, again, I feel like we're missing a puzzle piece. We're missing a puzzle piece because now Eliana's defense system is coming in to say, oh, you think I'm the problem. No, no, no. There's a reason why I have had to take the authority. There's a reason why this part of me is here in the building. It doesn't want to be here, but it's here because it has to be. So she said, I tried to explain. I tried to communicate with him. Right? So there's a part of her that tries to communicate and say, what she needs. And that she doesn't want him to stay in her house because she was being treated like a doormat. And then he responded, well, how are you going to do that to me and my child? And so then this part of her that advocates for her needs says, what's my house? And this is how I can say how I feel. Because when he comes here, she said, it hits me like a tidal wave. And then she's left to pick up everything, all the pieces when he leaves. And she becomes emotional around this. And so Orna, the therapist, acknowledges this and asks her, okay, I see you're upset. Tell me what's happening in the now. She said, well, I don't want to be this way. So this part of her is like, I don't want to be like this. I don't want to be authoritative or controlling. I don't want that. I want him to see the issues and deal with it. She said, it's embarrassing. Therapist said, how so? Because she said, I don't do anything half-assed. And she feels like she is in a relationship. She's in a relationship and doing life with someone who does. It becomes even more tearful, which then Mitch chuckles. So now she's in a really tender space. Eliana, really tender space. And then there was a chuckle. Ugh. Okay. And so then Eliana becomes really upset around the chuckle, like, you're laughing? You're laughing? And then what happens is they're fighting about, I don't even know if they know what they're fighting about. Who does the most? Who's the best partner? Whose worth is more important? Like, that's what's being fought in this moment. And I don't think that's really what the conversation is. Because it's like, there's no way you think you put in 100% in our relationship, says Mitch. And then Eliana's like, I'm not talking about you and me. I'm talking about our family as a whole. Well, you can't have me and you without, you know, we're a part of that family. And she's like, how many times? How many times have I can count on one hand how many times you've stepped up for me and my son or even for me. It's embarrassing. It's embarrassing. Okay. So I wonder how that lands on Mitch, because how he responds is, so if I don't show up for you and you're embarrassed, why are you here? It sounds like he heard, you're not good enough. You don't do enough. Which I don't know if that's what Eliana was trying to communicate. I heard her say, I want you to show up for me. And through the ears of protection, that could sound like you're not enough. Okay. And so Eliana says, because I want this to work. I want this to work. And then Mitch goes, so then put in effort, as if it's almost like, it's almost like Mitch is in a space where he's like, you want me to do something? Well, you got to do something too. And not to say that he's wrong. It's just in this moment, in this space, when the emotions are high, what's needed from both of them is to do what Lorena, who is from the Thruple, asks Josh to do. Be curious. But again, it's hard to do that. It's very hard to do that because you see both of their defenses are up and alert. So put in the effort. I do. And then Mitch, you don't. Hardly. So then Eliana began, she said, oh, so you want to say I hardly show up for you. I hardly put in effort for you. Eliana began to name instance after instance where she feels like she has shown up. This part for her is advocating for her truth to be heard. It's like multiple times, whether it's doing your clothes, your dirty laundry, whether it's stepping in for you to get your car inspected, like, I have shown up for you. I'm getting written up at work because I'm nursing our son in meetings. And that's why I got written up. I don't know if that's why she lost her job. Because she named that this is the first time in the 7 years that they've known each other that she has not been working, and her work is a part of who she is. So I'm like, aha, aha. Is there still unresolved hurt and anger about Mitch not showing up and how that resulted in her losing her job because she had to be a mom and working and didn't have any support? Is this what we need to be talking about? Is this what we need to be instead of like who cleans the bathroom and who cleans the kitchen? Like that, this feels like this needs to be the space. But instead, what happens, right? Eliana's naming, like, that's why I got written up for work because I was nursing while you were napping and because you were tired. He's like, well, I work. And he's like, you don't. Okay, so then he like throws the work, the fact that she doesn't work, you know, and not to negate that he isn't tired. He probably is very tired. And she's getting written up for her son being in the virtual meeting. So it's like both of these things are here. So what support do they need? Because it's not a Eliana need, it's not a Mitch need, it's a family need of like childcare, which is, you know, unfortunately a societal burden oftentimes, and belief that the woman in the relationship is supposed to be carrying the burden when it comes to the baby in, you know, into toddlerhood. And it's been shifting. Now we have paternity leave as well in some spaces, but even there, even still, there's this thought and belief, and Mitch's life too, his story has like reinforced that, which has caused him to show up in this way for Eliana and his son, and they're warring. And so the therapist stops them. She stops them, and he's like, it's the comparisons. It's like, because Eliana said, well, you work 40 hours a week just like everybody else does. Like, there's nothing special about that. That's the indirect. And for Mitch, it's like, it feels like you're putting me down, you're diminishing my efforts. And then Eliana's like, you know, this is the first time in 7 years that I haven't been working. And the therapist leans in, tell me what's upsetting you. And Eliana, from this part of her that really I'm hearing sees and defines herself through her work, speaks for its pain of like, that's who I am. I am my work. And I'm not working. So now I'm struggling. I'm carrying this pain of my identity, being a mom, and everything else on top of that. So the therapist says, okay, we are coming to a close. Are you still open to doing the experiment? In my mind, I'm like, I mean, I know this is your plan, right? This part of Orna that has a plan that's like, let's just see how this works. I hear, and I also wonder if we could pause the plan and attend to what Eliana just named. And maybe this is a part of Orna's plan. Who knows, right? To put some emphasis on Mitch carrying some of the load of the house, like the household responsibilities, could help Eliana be more present for the pain she's carrying around this loss of identity and having to navigate motherhood by herself and being in this relationship. Like it could maybe free up some space for that. Who knows? But whew. Let me know your thoughts, everyone, about what you're seeing with these couples. I'd be so curious to hear from you all, as these are some big dynamics that are happening with all of these couples, indeed. And if you're still with us, be sure to like the video, so of course, subscribe to the channel, and as always, be cool, be calm, be centered. Peace.